Hello everyone, so thanks for coming to my session. I'm going to talk about subfield lattice attack for overstretched entropy assumptions with some application for cryptanalysis analysis of some entropy-based FHE schemes and GDH-like gradient encoding schemes. So this is a joint work with Martin Albrecht from Roy Hollow and Leo Dukar from CWI. So I'm going to give an introduction of the overstretched entropy assumption. And then I'm going to talk about the method for the subfield lattice attack. So in the end, I'm going to summarize and give some recommendations. All right. So the problem we are facing is the entropy problem, where the general setup is that we are giving the security parameter lambda. And we are working usually in cyclotomic number fields, defined by the cyclotomic polynomial of order n. So the ring of integers has a degree n, which is phi m. So in this talk, we'll be focusing on power of two cyclotomic number fields, so where m is a power of two. Also, there are parameters modulus q, where we are doing the arithmetic on, and also we have another parameter, which is called the width parameter for convenience. So this controls the size of the secret, as we can see later. So both of the degree n and the width parameter sigma are usually a polynomial parameter of the lambda. So in the entropy key generation, we start with two secret keys, f and g. We generate them from the ring according to some distribution, where the size of f and g are controlled by the parameter sigma. So that's why I have said this width parameter here. And for the public key, we generate it by taking the reciprocal of two polynomials mod q. So the entropy problem parameterized by the parameter tau is that given h, public key h, and modulus q, such that we have the promise that h is a reciprocal of two secret polynomials, we ask to find the non-zero vector in this R2 of Euclidean norms smaller than some bound as a function of tau, where tau is the definition in the entropy problem, so in this R module. So it turns out that clearly f and g are in this R module. It turns out this R module is also a lattice. So to evaluate this, to consider this entropy problem, in this talk we'll be focusing on this a variant called overstretched entropy problem, where we are basically having the same setup, but we have a super polynomial modulus Q. So the entropy has many applications. For instance, in the famous entropy encrypt, it's also being used in signature schemes such as Bliss. So this overstretched entropy variance, which has a larger modulus, has been used in entropy-based FHE schemes, also in GDH-like gradient encoding schemes. So in order to evaluate the security of the entropy, so one way is to consider the lattice attack for the entropy problem. We mentioned before that this lambda h is a lattice of dimension 2n. It has a volume q to the n. And the Gaussian heuristic says that for a random lattice of volume qn, the shortest vector, the expected length of the shortest vector of this random lattice has norm approximately square root of nq. So this happens if h were uniformly randomly generated. But clearly this is not the case in the entropy if f and g are generated from a very small width parameter sigma. If this sigma is much smaller than q, then the existence of these vectors f and g are much smaller than the Gaussian heuristic. So in such case, we say that the lattice has unusual short vectors. Okay, so to use the lattice reduction to solve this, the previously mentioned lattice problem for entropy, so in practice, recovering a short enough vector of some targeted norm for this parameter tau is sometimes enough to solve the problem. So this tau parameter could be larger than sigma. So for instance, in entropy-based FHE schemes, so finding any vector of length of small order q would be considered a break for the scheme. And in practice and in theory, these parameters nq and sigma can be said to resist these attacks, both asymptotically and in practice. Okay, so that's the background so far. So in this talk, we are going to talk about a subfield lattice attack for this overstretched entry assumption. And we can see later that this attack is asymptotically faster than the full field attack as soon as Q becomes super polynomial. So as soon as the modulus becomes larger, our attack becomes more efficient. So our strategy can be summarized into three steps. So first of all, we mapped entry instance in the full field to some chosen subfield. And in the second step, we use the lattice reduction in this subfield to recover some vectors, which is hopefully helpful to solve the original problem. Since we are working in a subfield, we are essentially working for a smaller dimensional lattice. And hopefully this is easier to solve than the full field case. So in the end, we leave the solution back to the full field. Okay? And have a picturized proof for how does it work. So this is actually a terraced field, I think in China somewhere. And if we consider this a tower of fields, where the bottom is our full field, suppose we want to dig for some gold in the bottom layer, and we also consider this underground area for this layer. Then maybe in the full field, the searching region is too large. So instead of doing that, we climb up to some smaller, to some upper layers of smaller area, and we just dig for this layer. And hopefully the solution over here can help us to find the solution in the full field. So that's the philosophy idea of the attack. Okay. So I'd like to mention that, so the idea is has also been found concurrently and independently by Chen, Jun, and Li. They also use a similar subfield idea for attacking JGH-like graded encoding schemes. So the general approach is similar to us. But as we will see later, that we use the norm map to go down to the subfield. Instead, they use the trace map. Also, they consider the power of two cyclotomic fields, but they also have more powerful results against the gradient encoding scheme by using the zero testing parameter. And this idea actually. The subfield idea was already actually appeared in the old work of Gentry and Cicillo. And there they use a maximum real subfield for the cyclotomics. So therefore they consider a relative extension of degree two. And in the works they also attribute the work idea further to Johnson, Nguyen, and Stern. So I just would like to mention a little bit of background for this idea. Okay, so for the context of the attack. So in my talk, I will only consider the power of two cyclotomics, but the work is presented for more general number fields in our paper. So we have the full field K, which is a cyclotomic extension, where the N is the rank of the field, and we denote the ring of integer to be OK. So let L be a subfield of K. And similarly, I didn't put it here, I'm taking OL to be the ring of integers of L. So suppose that KN and L has degrees N and N prime, and their relative degree is R. So some fact is that K has a Galois group G, and we let the G prime be the subgroup that fixing this subfield L. So one thing that we will use is the norm map, which is a multiplicative map defined by the product of all the conjugates of this element F, where the conjugates are restricted to this subgroup. So this is the context. So this is a true picture, right, the overview of the attack. So we have the full field K over here, and the subfield is L, and their ring of integers. So the relative degree is R. And we start with some element public key H and some secret key G and F in the where G and F are secret. So these three elements are in the full field. And we use a norm map to norm them down. So since we only know the public information, we can know what is H prime, but we don't know G prime and F prime. So here we use a lattice reduction in the subfield based on the information of H prime. And we find some vectors x prime, y prime, and hopefully there is some relation between x prime, y prime with g prime, f prime. If that is true, then we can further lift the solution up to the full field. And since if there are some relation between x prime, y prime with g prime, f prime, we hope that we can also maintain this relation during the lifting. So that's the general idea of the attack. So the first step, so we want to norming elements down. So basically, I'm using the notation f prime to be the norm of f, and g prime to be the norm of g, and similar for h prime. So the only thing we need for this talk is that we want to know approximately what is the size of this, the norm of these elements. So the rule of thumb is that the norm is approximately the function of the R, where R is the extension degree, relative extension degree, and also it's relevant to the initial size of these polynomials f and g. And this norm is a vector in the subfield lattice. As we can see from this quantity that for large enough modulus and small enough R, this thing could be much smaller compared to Q. And therefore, there's a hope to still have some gap in the subfield lattice. And by having the gap, there's a hope to find F prime, G prime, or some related vectors in the subfield by using lattice reduction. Okay. So in the subfield, we use the lattice reduction. So for instance, we use the BKZ of block size beta in this subfield lattice. Then we can find a vector x prime, y prime, which is bounded by the this approximation factor guarantee of the BKZ multiplied by this the shortest vector of this subfield lattice. Since f prime g prime is a vector in the sublattice, it has to be larger than that. So the rule of thumb is that approximately this, we can find some vector x prime y prime upper bounded by this quantity, which is hopefully not too large. So we want to further argue that if these vectors x prime y prime we found over here is short enough, then it must be a OL multiple of the normed of the norms f prime g prime. So therefore, we can find some relation between x prime y prime and f prime g prime. So this will further allow us to lift this solution actually back to the full field to maintain this kind of relation. Okay. So so this is the second part of this, of the subfield. So we want to argue that if x prime y prime is not too large, then it has to be a OL multiple of f prime g prime. So formally, let f prime g prime be the elements in the subring, such that they are coprime, and such that h prime is the normed public key from h. And if x prime y prime in this subfield lattice has size upper bounded by q divided by f prime g prime, the norm of them, then we will know that x prime y prime is a multiple of f prime g prime for some multiples within this subring. So we will not give the full proof. Instead, we'll just give some ideas. So the point is in this intro lattices, if there exists some dense sublattices, then if these elements, the dense sublattices formed by this f prime g prime, they are pretty short. So if there are some vectors which are, for instance, much longer than this, then basically this f x prime y prime f prime g prime will actually form the generated whole lattice. So formally, we apply our volume argument to prove this. So therefore, a short enough vector x prime y prime in this sublattice belongs to this. So it's a multiple of this, our norm sequence. Okay. So in the end, we want to do the lifting. In the previous slide, we have found some element which is a multiple of the f prime g prime. We actually want to lift them back to the full field. So one way to do this is we can define this tutor f to be the product of all the conjugates of this f, which is an element of the in the ring of integers, then I'm just taking the x to be x prime, which can be rewritten by using this conjugate as the v times tutor f times f mod q. And further, this y is defined to be y prime times h divided by h prime. And if we expand h and h prime using the relation such that h equals to j over f mod p, and then rewritten the formula, then that eventually becomes v times tutor f times g mod q. And therefore, we realize that xy is actually an OK multiple of fg, where this OK element is v times tutor of f. So some further analysis show that not only xy is an OK multiple of f and g, its size can also be upper bounded by these asymptotics. So where this approximation part are essentially from the previous BKZ reduction part over here, and the second part actually from the loss on the side when we are doing the norming down. Okay. So for some asymptotics of this attack, so we take the relative degree r to be log q divided by log n. So this value is set up in order to optimize to minimize the block size beta divided by log beta. So the subfield lattice attack can solve these overstretch intro assumptions or just intro assumptions in time this 2 to the theta beta with the block size beta such that beta divided by log beta is asymptotically n times log n divided by log q squared. So by comparison, if we do the direct lattice attack for the full field, this b divided by log beta is n divided by log q. So therefore, this attack is better as soon as the q gets super polynomial. Okay. So I'm going to talk about the impacts of this attack on entropy-based FHE and multilinear maps. So for both stretchable entropy-based FHE, such as LTV and Yashi, so this subfield lattice attack gave a circuit exponential attack with respect to the security parameter. And also for multilinear maps, the latest improvement of GGH, which is given by the ACCL paper, so we can recover some partial information on the secrets by just having a polynomial attack. So this happens when we have big enough multilinear degree. But in order to finalize, because we only recover a multiple of this secret, we still have to use a quantum step to finalize the attack to solve some principal ideal problem. This becomes a quantum polynomial if we calculate them together. And if you want to use the attack by chain, then this gives you a classical attack by using the zero testing parameter. So this attack does not need, because it's an algebraic attack for the assumption, we don't need any encodings of zero, nor the zero testing parameter. Okay. So this is some comparison of this this subfield lattice attack. So this is the prior status of this. So in the x-axis, we have the approximation factor, the function of n. And in the y-axis, we have the time for attacking this problem. So for this multilinear map, so we have an approximation factor of already sub-exponential. So therefore, in terms of n, so we already got a sub-exponential attack with respect to the n. And for this is also the case for Yashi, but it is a slight sub-exponential. So for entro and bliss, the parameters are set up such that they are, the approximation factors are polynomial, therefore the attacks are sub-exponential. Okay. And by the subfield lattice attack, we can further reduce the time for this GGH by reducing it from sub-exponential to polynomial, and also we can further reduce the time on attacking Yashi. But this reduces it to but the running asymptotic running time for this is still sub-exponential, but to a larger order. And this does not seem to affect the entry and the bleed asymptotically. Okay. So I'm going to talk about the, in particular, the entry encrypt and the bleed signature schemes. So if the norm of FG is not a very short vector in the subfield lattice, then the lattice reduction wouldn't recover any information on this vector. So this happens if they are similar to the Gaussian heuristic, which is square root of n prime times q. So because our attack is a subfield, so the minimum one we can take for the relative extension degree is 2. So we use that to test for the immunity of these n2 parameters. So this n2743 is perfectly immune, which means that even getting down to a subfield of relative degree 2, it becomes close to that. So there's no way we can recover that using this method. And for n2401 and the bleed, so they are close to this, but there are some constant factors, seems to be some factors over there. But maybe, I don't know if these are enough to immune for this attack totally or not. So another observation is that theoretically, if we're taking this width parameter to be big enough, to be square root of q of omega, then this n true implies this ring RW problem because over there H is almost uniform random. But in terms of our attack, actually the immunity comes from even by taking this sigma to be a quarter root of this q, because if we are going down by degree of 2, this becomes square root of q. So therefore, can we prove something of this? Or I don't know, maybe next slide can give some extra hints on this. So come to the conclusion of the slides, of the talk. So our initial recommendation is that we recommend that this setup, so the entry assumption, presents of subfields and with large modulus and small width parameters considered to be insecure. And actually there's a follow-up work by Kirshner and Fuch. So in this e-print comparison between subfield and straightforward attacks on entry, so they instead of going down to the subfield, they can use some straightforward lattice attack by projecting to the subring. So their results, using their method, they can actually break Yashi in practice for some concrete parameters. And they also realize that because they seem to behave better for entry lattice than the previously thought. And one big difference is that in their attack, they don't need the subfields. So they have the same asymptotic results, but without needs for subfields. So therefore, it works very generically. So, and also they conclude that the entry seems to be weaker than ring LRB, whatever the ring structure is. So that concludes my talk. And this is the paper. Thank you.